herbicides, and pesticides. The Green Revolution was the brainchild of the Rockefeller Foundation's Natural Science Division in partnership with large agricultural corporations. Petroleum-based agriculture provided vast new profits for the oil industry, but never lived up to its promises of ending hunger and promoting health. The Green Revolution did at first increase productivity because every bit of soil was being used for immediate production. But its true costs can now be seen. Taxpayers pay billions in subsidies to giant agribusiness corporations. Small family farms have all but disappeared. Biodiversity is destroyed. Toxic chemicals poison farm workers and pollute the land, water, and our food supply, endangering the health of us all. As of 2010, approximately one in every seven people worldwide did not have enough to eat.
The giant corporations who had brought us chemicals for chemical industrial agriculture, and they were talking about three instruments to consolidate the food chain. The first was genetic engineering as a way of control. The second was patenting seed and patenting life as a way of control, declaring seed to be private property, treating the saving of seed by farmers as a crime, as a theft of intellectual property. And the third was so-called free trade treaties that would rob ordinary people, farmers, growers, of their freedom to save seed. The design of Terminator technology to create sterile seed in order to impose even more dependence of humanity on a handful of corporations is the ultimate step in this. We are, through what we are doing with seed, literally for the first time, creating a new colonization, which I call the colonization of the future.
So in two crucial areas, energy and food, the same elite banking families and their corporations have taken control, and the consequences have been devastating. For me, it was overwhelming at first to discover such a monopoly of influence, but I knew it was important. Like learning you have a tough but treatable disease, it helps to understand what's causing it and how it operates if the goal is to cure it. So I continued my investigation. If oil and food are controlled by the big banking families, where else does their influence show up? As I followed the money, I began to see this same pattern of control in just about every area of our lives. And I always found the same families in charge, either directly through their banks and corporations, or indirectly through their major foundations. Again, it was the Rockefellers who created the National Education Association, with help from the Carnegie Foundation and later from the Ford Foundation. What the captains of industry wanted from our schools was an obedient and docile workforce who would be manageable employees and eager consumers.
Schools are to establish fixed habits of response to authority. That's why it takes 12 years. You're to respond reflexively when anyone in a position of authority tells you what to do.
Like education, health is yet another area dominated by big money and corporations. The American Medical Association, for example, is largely funded by the Rockefellers, who use their funding to influence AMA research and decision making.
The average MD in 4 years of medical school takes one course in nutrition, 2.5 hours in many cases, and the materials used, the curriculum materials, are supplied by the National Dairy Council and the National Livestock and Meat Board and other industries, including the Sugar Association, with products to sell that actually undermine our health in the first place.
Unfortunately, the way the system of medicine is set up, medical education is primarily funded by pharmaceutical companies. So there's a motive to make and sell as many drugs as possible. It's also a very time-effective way of making money for the physician, for the pharmaceutical company, for the whole medical establishment. But it's really perpetuating the problems it was meant to alleviate.
Side effects may include nausea, dry mouth, and constipation.
Decreases in white blood cells, which can be serious.
Sexual side effects, diarrhea, nausea, and sleepiness.
Can lead to coma or death.
How far will these forces go to make a profit? Would they actually suppress cures for diseases the way they've suppressed free energy technology? Sadly, my research has shown me the answer is yes. One well-documented example is the case of Dr. Royal Rife. In the 1920s, Dr. Rife invented the most advanced microscopes of his time. He also developed a new technique he called coordinative resonance, which was apparently able to destroy cancerous tumors as well as viruses. In 1934, in clinical trials affiliated with the University of Southern California, Rife's treatment was tested on 16 terminally ill cancer patients. Within 3 months, they were all successfully cured. Soon after, a lab testing Rife's technology was burned down and a frivolous lawsuit was filed. Through the efforts of Morris Fishbein, head of the Journal of the American Medical Association, Rife was essentially shut down and ruined, his brilliant and promising work all but forgotten.
It was really hard for me to consider that someone might actually be suppressing cures. And cancer has run through my family like a raging river. I found out that it's all about patents. If a pharmaceutical company can patent and make money from treatment, especially one that we have to keep on using, then that's what we get. Otherwise, we don't even hear about it. It's not just Rife who got shut down. Reen Case had an old Indian Ojibwe formula that was effective. Harry Hoxie and Max Gerson had natural remedies that worked. But you know, if you go and you look them up, the AMA makes them sound like complete quacks. And that's where following the money has been so helpful, because the same powers who control the AMA and their research and funding control the pharmaceuticals. So there's a multi-trillion dollar financial incentive to suppress cures that can't be patented. Knowing that cures exist has not taken away the anguish I feel from losing so many people I love to cancer. It's given me something really satisfying to do with the pain. And I believe when we take the love and devotion that we have for everyone who's died and who will die unnecessarily, and directed to developing and getting these cures out to people who need them, we can break this cancer legacy and heal.
As difficult as it was for me, I have come to an inescapable and profoundly disturbing conclusion. I believe that an elite group of people and the corporations they run have gained control over not just our energy, food supply, education, and healthcare, but over virtually every aspect of our lives. And they do it by controlling the world of finance, not by creating more value, but by actually controlling the source of money. When I followed the money, I found that it took me up the levels of a pyramid. Here we are at the bottom level, going about our daily lives. Above us is government, people who are given a monopoly on force and use it to tax and control us whether or not we agree. But who controls them? At the next level are the corporations. Many would say that it is now corporations and not nation states that rule the world. They call it a corporatocracy. To acquire the world's resources and control the markets, this corporatocracy must have access to cheap money. The big corporations get their loans at special rates from the big banks, which means that those who control the major banks, the moneyed elite, ultimately control the corporations. As I've followed the money, I've learned that almost everything I once believed about money is simply not true.
It's interesting how few questions we actually ask about very everyday things, like when we go into a bank and we ask for a loan of, say, $50,000, £50,000, what actually happens? You see, most people live their lives based on a kind of vague image of what happens. What actually happens is you ask for £50,000, They type into your account £50,000. That's all they do. They don't mint any coins. They don't print any money. They don't move any precious metal anywhere. They just put £50,000 into your account on a computer screen. From that moment, you start paying interest on money that has never, does not, and will never exist.
It turns out that banks actually have about 9 times as much money loaned out as they have on reserve in their vaults. This is possible because of what's referred to as fractional reserve lending. The way it works is that the Federal Reserve, or the central bank in any country, is legally allowed to determine the amount a bank must have on reserve. In the US, it's currently around 10%. So if you deposit $10,000 into the bank sets aside 10%, or $1,000, and then loans out the rest of your money. The way it works is, say another person comes into the bank and asks for a car loan of $9,000. At this moment, the bank loans out the $9,000 from your original deposit. It isn't there anymore. The borrower then pays the person selling the car, and they go deposit the money into another bank, which is part of the same central banking system. This $9,000 is treated as a new deposit, and the process continues. The money gets redeposited and reloaned until the initial deposit of $10,000 becomes $100,000. The banking system just created $90,000 by loaning out your money. Apparently, it began with the goldsmiths in the 17th century when people were trading in gold. Gold was heavy to carry around, so people stored the actual metal in vaults and traded receipts instead. Those receipts were the first paper money. Since only a few people would withdraw their gold at any given time, the vault owners, basically the new bankers, began creating receipts for more metals than they actually held. They loaned out those receipts and charged interest on money, gold, that they didn't really have. That's how our so-called fractional reserve system was born. In this system, the bankers get to make up money out of nothing, while the rest of us have to work hard to earn it. It has created a modern form of serfdom where the mass of society is now working to pay off their debt to the banks. Under this fractional reserve scheme, we inevitably become debt slaves to a ruling class of financial elite. Not because they are better or smarter than anyone else, but because they have rigged the system to benefit themselves at the expense of most people on the planet. Catherine Austin Fitz is an expert on this issue. She was an assistant secretary of Housing and Urban Development under President George Bush Sr., and then an advisor to the Clinton administration.
Let's set up a game of Monopoly and you want to buy Park Place. What I can continually do is just print money, give myself more money, lower the value of your money by printing more. No matter how hardworking you are or how successful you are, I can always end up buying you for free.
So how come if you or I make up money, it's called counterfeiting? But if the banks do it, it's increasing the money supply. How did the banks get this power? This is Jekyll Island, where in 1910, representatives from the Rockefellers, Rothschilds, Morgans, and other private bankers gathered secretly to draft the legislation that would create the Federal Reserve. Ed Griffin literally wrote the book on what happened at Jekyll Island.
Central banks are banking cartels which have gone into partnership with the respective governments in the countries where they operate. And they've been given monopolistic power over the creation of the nation's money supply. That's what the politicians handed to them as a gift, you might say, for the partnership. Now, in return, what did the bankers do for the politicians? They promised to create money out of nothing, now that they've got this legal power to do it, anytime the government needs it.
And since 2008, we've witnessed the greatest fake money printing run in recorded history. This financial sleight of hand disguises the costs, hides who's to blame, and leaves us as debt slaves working to pay off the bill. I found it revealing that in the same year the Federal Reserve was founded, 19... 19-